Okay, thank you, Adam. Mark Osmer is a hard act to follow, and I'm going to be speaking, going further downstream with disease of the small bowel and talking about the various modalities that we can commonly use. We're not talking about any exotic instruments. We're going to be talking about ileal colonoscopy, how it can help us in the small bowel. Then we'll talk about capsule, which has now been present for well over a decade, and how it can help us again in a practical way, as well as prognostic factors, and then finally double balloon, which I think is only something used by a small fraction of people in the audience because of its cumbersome nature. So, how to access and determine severity and complication of small bowel. Again, colonoscopy, capsule endoscopy, and double balloon. Ileal colonoscopy, in the next lecture, Frank Foray is going to talk about it in terms of measuring the simple and not quite so simple. It's a little bit cumbersome still, and we don't need it in day-to-day practice, the simple endoscopic score for Crohn's disease, and then the Routh-Geertz score. And Frank will show you some very nice video of how we calculate the endoscopic score. It's easy to assess, cumbersome, and in real life we don't really need it. We have an intuitive knowledge of which patients have severe disease. And here we're talking about what can be reached during a colonoscopy, namely the ileum, and then four additional segments through the colon, ascending, transverse, descending, and rectum, and compiling the score that includes ulcers, percentage of the circumference that has an ulcerated surface, an affected surface, and strictures. And this is really useful now in clinical trials. There was a much more complicated CDEIS, Crohn's disease endoscopic index of severity, very cumbersome, required a lot more time, even for people sitting and reading these for a living. But when you're looking at clinical trials now, obviously the FDA has moved to looking at objective measures of inflammation, and this is something you're going to see. And in general, they're asking for a score of 4 or less, and again, Frank is going to be speaking about this in more detail. What I will be speaking about in some additional detail is the use of ileal colonoscopy, and this should be our bread and butter now. We should really have not need a back of the envelope calculation, but just be able to look at a ileal colonoscopy, typically at 6 months after an ileocolic resection, the most common operation that's done for Crohn's disease, to help guide us in terms of treating the patient if we have not already started treatment, in fact, after an ileocolic resection based on patient's clinical factors. So if we do start the patient typically on an anti-TNF because the patient does have a number of high prognostic risk factors for early recurrence, such as early surgery after presentation, young age, surgery for a penetrating disease, and cigarette smoking. Those patients will probably be started on early, but we'll look at 6 months to see if it's adequate. Patients in more of a gray zone for early disease recurrence will look for the first time at 6 months, and that will help guide us in terms of who should start medical therapy. So you see here on the left a pristine normal mucosa. Again, this is within the first 10 centimeters proximal to the ileocolic anastomosis, pristine. Routh-Geertz 1 is a single aptus ulcer or less than 5 aptus ulcers. A Routh-Geertz 2 is somewhat nebulous because if you have not 5 or less aptus erosions, but let's say 6, does that tip you off into a much more aggressive disease course? And then as Miguel Ruggiero has taught us, there are I2s, Routh-Geertz score 2s that are more like 1s, basically 6 aptus erosions instead of 5. And then there are more quote-unquote ugly looking Routh-Geertz 2. We see a lot more erythema perhaps, but not quite enough to call it a Routh-Geertz 3, which is where you have no normal mucosa, ulcerations, but no normal mucosa. Clearly these patients do require aggressive therapy, and Routh-Geertz 4 without question, as you'll see on the next slide in terms of a Kaplan-Meier. This patient, we've already waited too long to start treatment, or if the patient has started anti-TNF therapy right after surgery, this patient really has an abysmal outlook. So here you see a very good long-term outlook if you have just less than 5 erosions. If you have more than 5 erosions, again, some I2s look like Routh-Geertz 1, some look more like Routh-Geertz 3. If you have a Routh-Geertz 3, again, ulceration with no normal mucosa, and you have 100% recurrence, and many of these patients have had surgery by year 4 if they've already had this kind of nasty-looking Routh-Geertz inflammation at 6 months after surgery. So I think everyone at this point is very comfortable and familiar with ileocolic anastomotic strictures. This is the most common stricture by far we see in the small bowel. Often they're right at the staple line, this beautifully concentric stricture. They are usually not that symptomatic until they narrow down, and even when they do narrow down substantially, you'll be surprised that they are sometimes barely symptomatic. If they are symptomatic, we are comfortable, as we usually learn even during fellowship, at dilating these with balloons. 12 to 15 is probably far more than enough. Bo Shen will show you videos that will give you great trepidation. Hopefully he didn't have too much coffee in your system when he shows you his needle knives of some more aggressive refractory strictures, less pliable in terms of opening up. Again, symptomatic strictures. Just because the stricture is there, if the patient's entirely asymptomatic, they don't require endoscopic intervention, but they might require medical therapy. So if you look at success of stricture dilation, this is a typical picture. This, I would say, is only in Routgierts 1. Usually, always we have to assess whether there is accompanying inflammation. There you see a single ulcer, balloon insertion, and then adequate dilation. But with even in the very good hands, remember, again, that some of these strictures are just nothing more than that pretty concentric narrowing, but many of them have inflammatory changes as well. And at the 20-month point after your initial dilation, symptom recurrence is 3/4 of patients, need for redilation 3/4 of patients, and need for surgery in about 1/4 of patients, in almost half of patients. So this is good for early symptomatic response in terms of avoiding early surgery. Perhaps the patient needs medical therapy to get them over the hump. And in fact, we see that in terms of the role of medical therapy, other than that perfectly benign used in the terms of endoscopic appearance, not benign versus malignant, that round, circular, non-inflamed anastomotic stricture. Again, most of these have inflammatory components, and in this univariate analysis, you see what helped them was a medical therapy. But more importantly than looking at a single therapy, monotherapy with anti-TNF, if you look at the outcomes of dilatation in terms of preventing the need for a second one, the only thing here that reduces the likelihood of dilation or surgery is combination therapy, reducing it by about 3/4. If you look at a long stricture in a non-statistical way, not surprisingly, those patients need more frequent and earlier redilation. Again, in terms of a Kaplan-Meier curve, dramatic differences if you choose not to use medical therapy in a patient in whom you dilate and don't add combination therapy. Now, that all refers to patients with various aspects, various features of ileocolic anastomotic strictures. These are patients we're looking at with both colonic and ileal, purely ulcerated, very, very inflammatory strictures. And these patients, you can imagine, will fare a lot better with aggressive medical therapy, if fare well at all. And dilating these patients is fraught with danger, and probably we would all recognize that these patients will benefit first or most from medical therapy. On the left, you can see patients with attempts at dilation, and this is probably way overestimation of success. About 20% of patients have success compared to the ileocolic anastomosis, a meta-analysis, about 30%. But again, the pictures I showed you on the prior slide, I would say probably you have about a 90% failure rate at reducing and widely opening up those deeply ulcerated and inflammatory strictures. Now, how about using capsule endoscopy? This isn't a talk about the value of capsule endoscopy, but focusing on assessing disease activity and its complications. How is it really helpful to us? Most of us are using capsule endoscopy, I imagine, 90% of the time for obscure bleeding, not in IBD patients. So how is it helpful in a patient who we know already has Crohn's disease? Well, we want to see if the patient has active disease when the patient is a bit puzzling to us. They have normal imaging, perhaps they have minimal inflammatory markers, SED rate, CRP, fecal calprotectin, and yet we have not been able to pinpoint, even with our most recent CTs or MREs, we're not able to find active inflammation. We are looking to check response to medical therapy. This might be useful. You just heard from Mark Osterman how important the presence of jejunal lesions are. This can be far more sensitive, detected by a capsule endoscopy than by cross-sectional imaging. You will have obscure bleeding in patients with known Crohn's disease, and obviously if there's a suspicious mass lesion on a CT or an MR, or with a flyby view on a capsule endoscopy, where obviously you can't control the speed of the movement through this lesion, then you will ultimately need a double balloon. So one point I want to make is that this was a paper early on that was widely quoted and really led to a lot of patients being overly diagnosed, misdiagnosed with Crohn's disease. And this was called mucosal breaks. And if you had more than three of these mucosal breaks, they had labeled those patients with Crohn's disease, which is really doing our patients a disservice. Patients come in with vague symptoms. They don't have hard inflammatory markers. They get a capsule. They see, quote unquote, three mucosal breaks, and they're labeled as Crohn's disease. They get 5-ASA for their small bowel disease, which does not work even if they have Crohn's, legitimate Crohn's small bowel disease. They don't respond perhaps to steroids if they have a lot of abdominal pain and cramps and perhaps diarrhea. They don't respond to our newer biologics. And the reason they don't respond to all these drugs is they don't have Crohn's. And biologics combination therapy doesn't work well for irritable bowel with a couple of mucosal breaks. So if all you have to hang your hat on are these few mucosal breaks, for instance, if you saw these in the colon, you wouldn't say, gee, the patient has obvious colonic disease. You should make sure that we don't label our patients with Crohn's disease based upon these really paltry jejunal lesions seen on a capsule. Now, Mark spoke about very nicely about the importance of jejunal lesions, which is something we haven't really focused on, but based upon what the data that Mark just showed, and I'll show you again briefly to reiterate, jejunal lesions are something that are often hidden from us, especially the smaller ones, which are not picked up on CT or MR enterography, and they are seen more frequently in patients who have ileal disease than patients with solely colonic disease, and no other risk factors will tell you which patient has the presence of those jejunal lesions. But the presence of these jejunal lesions is a bad prognostic sign in times of relapse after medical therapy. Now, does that mean a patient who we're starting off with active disease, we're treating and we have the usual inflammatory markers present, we have an impressive CT or MR enterography, patient improves 100% clinically, he's back to a normal CRP, sedimentation rate, calprotectin, hemoglobin, feels great. Do we need to do a capsule to identify whether they have jejunal lesions? I don't think so, but if it's part of their workup, they've had findings of jejunal lesions, that's probably a patient I'm going to pay a lot more attention to, have a lower threshold to treat more aggressively. This is, again, Mark Lazarev, a wonderful fellow from Mount Sinai IBD, who's now established himself as a very important researcher at Johns Hopkins. This is Steve Brandt's database that Mark just spoke about, the IBD Genetic Consortium, over 2,000 patients, and they had 115 patients who had disease limited to the jejunum, and they had a threefold likelihood. Again, this is without ileal disease, purely jejunal disease. If you identify it, again, that patient has likely a more aggressive course. In terms of predictions of stricturing disease, again, this is, besides early age of onset, the most telling, the worst prognosticator for who is going to get jejunal disease, so who's going to get stricturing disease and ultimately surgery. So we have not yet routinely looked for jejunal disease, but if we do look for it because we have some other reason to look for it, the patient is not entirely well, they've had adequate ileocolonoscopy, adequate cross-sectional imaging, they are not entirely well, at least biochemically, a capsule endoscopy would be helpful in telling us, is this patient require yet more aggressive therapy? This is a follow-up to the original STORY trial, which followed patients for approximately 18 months. This is a study where patients were followed after withdrawal of infliximab and then continued on azathioprine. And there were a number of inflammatory markers that predicted which patients were likely to have a recurrence and need reinstitution of their anti-TNF. Fortunately, in the original STORY trial, patients who did relapse after withdrawal of infliximab, about 90% almost had reinstitution of remission with reinstitution of their infliximab. Remember, those patients were on azathioprine, less likely to form antibodies in the interim. The more extended STORY trial looked at, again, the same poor prognostic factors of patients who are likely to relapse off infliximab, patients who basically showed you that had ongoing inflammation despite adequate infliximab levels. Obviously, if you're withdrawing infliximab in the setting of active disease, as you see here with elevated inflammatory markers, as simple as an elevated white blood cell count and a low hemoglobin, obviously that patient is more likely to have a relapse when you withdraw their anti-TNF. but we didn't think about jejunal lesions in the original STORY trial. Here we're looking at the importance, again, of jejunal lesions. Jejunal lesions has been an unrecognized bad thing, and a capsule will pick up on that more readily. It's more sensitive than cross-sectional imaging. Here's a patient with abdominal pain, normal cross-sectional imaging, still with elevated CRP and calprotectin. And I'll just ring the bell that more patients these days are telling us they have abdominal pain even without even without an elevated CRP and calprotectin. Maybe, and this is not to cast aspersions on our Crohn's patients, and it's legitimate that a lot of patients with Crohn's disease without inflammatory markers want to get medical marijuana. Again, this is not drug-seeking behavior. There are various mechanisms for pain in patients in whom we cannot find it with colonoscopy and cross-sectional imaging. And here we see a patient who did not have evidence of demonstrable inflammation or stricturing, again, on colonoscopy or cross-sectional imaging. And here, clearly, there is, in the mid-jejunum, a significant ulceration. You wouldn't mistake this for a small apophyseal erosion. So here we know clearly that this is picking up disease that we're not seeing with our other imaging techniques, and the patient obviously warrants aggressive medical therapy. Now, how about capsule endoscopy? Normal colonoscopy, and we have a breakout section this afternoon where we talk about a therapeutic endoscopy in patients with Crohn's disease. You will find patients who have normal colonoscopies, normal cross-sectional imaging, and they have iron deficiency anemia in the absence of a known source. And you've perhaps done other tests in the past. You have not found active disease. They have refractory iron deficiency anemia. These days, hopefully, most of us are using intravenous iron to rectify that anemia. And here you could see in a patient with normal cross-sectional imaging, you see active inflammation with friability. You're not going to see generally active bleeding, oozing fresh blood, but you'll see obvious friability in the setting of ulceration. This too tells us that the patient will need a more aggressive medical therapy. Obviously, this is not something that we treat therapeutically with a scope. Now let's move on to double balloon. I doubt there are more than 10% or probably less of us doing double balloon. It is very cumbersome, time consuming. Where is it useful though? Where should we be referring? When should we be referring our patients to our local expert endoscopist? Well, when we're looking for obscure bleeding, somewhat like the patient I just showed, and this the test will be done, the double balloon enteroscopy, after a capsule imaging to start with. We can treat anastomotic bleeding that we see as perhaps on the prior patient. We could do balloon dilation on strictures that we see with any prior imaging test. We could biopsy suspicious lesions seen on prior imaging, and we can do retrieval of retained capsules and eliminate the need for surgery in the vast majority of those patients. So this is a typical balloon dilation. This is not at an anastomosis. This is at a fibrotic stricture in the mid-jejunum. Nothing magical about this. If you're doing ileocolonoscopy, do stricture dilation, and you're somebody who does double balloon enteroscopy, it is exactly the same technique. It is not an easy procedure. There's usually a couple of strictures that are dilated on that first go-through, and you could see here at the very bottom that it takes anywhere from, and this is in expert hands, anywhere from a half an hour to 3 hours, and that's probably in large part why we're referring these patients out. But it does reduce the likelihood of surgery dramatically if you're dealing with fibrotic strictures. If you look at patients who had fistulizing disease in combination with their stricturing disease, again, this is inflammatory disease, and you can imagine that avoiding surgery long term when you're dealing with inflammatory disease, that obviously is not going to get better with any sort of endoscopic dilation. We will see patients who, and this is a patient who was asymptomatic for many years, was in a clinical remission 20 years later, and that should always prompt suspicion for something bad when a patient's been asymptomatic for decades, comes in many years later with, in this case, symptoms of anemia and abdominal pain. Cross-sectional imaging with an MR was suspicious for that lesion you saw, and biopsies revealed an adenocarcinoma. Adenocarcinoma in small bowel, as you know, still is a minute risk in terms of absolute risk, but in terms of relative risk is greatly increased compared to people without IBD. Lastly, again, in patients who we could not find a source of iron deficiency bleeding, and maybe the patient had a capsule endoscopy that did or did not direct us to a specific area. Double balloon enteroscopy is very effective, not just in terms of Well, that didn't show. Control, identifying a source of bleeding and then treating the bleeding in the same way that we would treat it endoscopically. If it is an endoscopic bleed, we can treat it with various endoscopic modalities. Again, if it is at an anastomosis. If we're dealing with diffuse inflammatory bleeding, obviously double balloon doesn't help us with that. So where finally does a double balloon rescue us? When we have a retained capsule, we are trying to avoid having the retained capsule removed by human fingers. And here it's obviously because of a stricture in these cases. And here we find that in the right hands, you could see the reflux of intestinal contents. The capsule is easily seen. It's been identified very easily on that cross-sectional imaging. It's not difficult in the right hands to retrieve it and remove it and avoid a surgery. If it's not a fibrotic stricture, then those patients obviously we're going to treat with aggressive medical therapy. So, take-home messages. Colonoscopy and balloon dilation. This is something that's in our own hands and every gastroenterologist here. Valuable tool, and we're doing this every day of the week, to identify those patients who are post-op and will help us identify whether our patients need maintenance therapy after surgery or whether the maintenance therapy we instituted after surgery is working. Higher success rate of balloon dilation if we have inflammation at the ileocolic anastomosis and we add therapy, particularly in these patients, combination therapy. By definition, these patients have already had surgery. We're trying to treat them aggressively to prevent them from their second operation. If we are treating non-anastomotic but inflammatory strictures, we do less well. And that is it. Thank you very much.